it together. That's what I say to me. I put on the pressure. You could do better. Be who you're supposed to be. But that's when you came in, right when I needed you. You said all of the things that I was believing, not one of them were true. You lifted my head up, I was keeping my head down. I didn't know love, but I do now. 'Cause you stood right there, and then you broke up apart the lies. You told me I had something beautiful inside.
Before I even get into that journey that we've been on, I heard something this weekend. Because we're on a holiday weekend, we're here today in our annual Ugly Sweater Sunday. We have a cookie extravaganza after our service today. We're cutting the ribbon on a convo cafe. It's just a great day of celebration. And so how many of you know you can be at a celebration and there may be people there who are going through so much, they have a difficult time joining in celebration. And so what has to happen, we have to be, as people of God, very conscious that there are people who don't even have a smile. There are people who have nothing to smile about. There are people that are in so much turmoil, so much trouble, so many challenges that they'd rather sit in a corner in the dark and not be around anybody. And so that state of mind is a very serious state of mind, and it's not to be taken lightly. And so whenever you come around family, friends, co-workers, you can be celebrating even in an ugly shirt, but God, make me sensitive to someone who's suicidal. Somebody sensitive to someone who says they have no reason for living. Sensitive to someone who is depressed. Sensitive to someone who really doesn't know why am I here. And are in so much pain. What happens is, and I heard these words, that when a happy person is around a painful person, the painful person, it accentuates the pain. And so it's very important that we can go through life, and the Bible says that the joy of the Lord is our strength, right? And so God help us to have his joy, but that joy still has to be sensitive around people who need a little love. We need a little understanding that even though things, I may be coming out of my desert and you're in the middle of yours, all I can tell you is God that brought me out will bring you out, and I will hold your hand, I will hug you, I will serve you, whatever I need to do to lift you. Yes. So I'm asking us to be sensitive. Yes. That's what I'm asking. Because we can get caught up in just us. Yes. Me and mine. And my gifts and my time. And so it's not about us. The Bible says, that's the scripture I'm putting before you. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility. Somebody say in humility. It takes humility to see others above yourself. To say, I see in your eyes that you're sad. I know you're trying to go on with the little work party, but I see in your eyes that you're sad. Can you want to talk about it? Is there anything I can do? Are we understanding this? It's so important that we do that. In fact, that's a perfect segue into why God put that on my heart, because we're on a series all month in December called Ambassadors for Real. And in being real ambassadors, how many of you know, we have to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit and who's around us and what people may be going through. And you can say, can I offer a prayer? Whatever I can do. And so it's important. They can know God, they may not know God. Either way, it's important. And so the reason why this series means so much is because we've learned in here, Jesus died for us so that we can live for him. And so that's why he has called us ambassadors. And so on this journey, I have to do quickly because today we're going to take us to the fourth part. And I really believe the Lord is speaking this very seriously. And so, in case you wondered if the words ambassador in the Bible, it's in 2 Corinthians 5:19-20. And the one part I will read in verse 20 says, so we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal, that means his appeal to people that don't know him, through us. We speak for Christ. Somebody say for him. Yeah, literally. When we plead to people, come back to God. That is our purpose as ambassadors. Say to someone, do what? Come back to God. In other words, we have learned on this series that we're not tourists. We're not immigrants. We're ambassadors. We're not just touring the world with getting pleasure. We're not immigrants trying to even fit in. We are ambassadors on assignment. And the one scripture that God gave us for that was Hebrews 11:13-16. Just make it in your notes. This is not where we're going to hang out today, but it's to let you know God said we were pilgrims and strangers on the earth. When you gave your heart to the Lord, by the way, he chose you. You came out of darkness into light. And so we've learned on this ambassador series that ambassadors need to know who they are. Did we not learn that? They also need to know that they don't fit in. So whenever you're an ambassador, whenever God saves you and gives you new life and pulls you out of situations, you will never fit in again. And you go through life changing from old to new, but as you're changing, the things I used to do, I don't do anymore. The places that were comfortable are now uncomfortable. Are you understanding? In other words, the round doesn't fit in the square, or the square doesn't fit in the round. If you try to fit it, pieces of you are going to be broken. Are you understanding this? This slide, for me, is going to really minister about who we are. And then that other thing we learned, that we are ambassadors and we're to keep it real. Remember this? And so one of the acronyms God gave us, very simple. Ambassadors are representatives, right? Empowered, right? And loving. So if somebody was saying, well, what's a real ambassador? I'm a representative who's been empowered, and God helped me to be what? Come on, let's say it. I know it's not easy for certain people or certain conditions, but you have been called to be loving. Now, someone sent me, because I'm into acronyms, I guess you figured that out. Someone sent me another acronym for keeping it real. I just got this week, and ambassadors are revitalized, energetic, and anti-lethargic. I like that. God, help me to be revitalized and energized and anti-what? And that word just means apathetic, you know, just existing. And so we know we're people of purpose and we don't just exist. The other thing that we learned in that first part is that ambassadors leave a scent. Now, this is really key, even in being sensitive. So when you go into sensitive situations, a person can say, you know, I can't believe that person was that discerning, that they took the time and asked if they could pray for me, or they asked if I was okay. They weren't so into themselves that they took a moment. They weren't such in a hurry that they took a moment. And how many of you know when you do that, you leave a fragrance. You leave a scent of God's love. And that's what we've learned in this first part. And then we kept it moving about ambassadors being real. And we said that we have been called to be the embassy suite for God. Well, what does that mean? You know, if you ever stayed in one of those hotels, it's a very nice facility, most of them, right? And so what God is saying is that my home and my life is his embassy. That's what he wants us to understand, that literally I'm an embassy for the true king. And so when we learn that, the difference in an embassy suite Christian is a professional one. What? Yeah, there are professional Christians. In fact, this week I was talking to someone and we were at a party actually, and I said, you know, that smells like a professional Christian. And I was talking about myself, something I said. I said, oh, what I just said smells like a professional Christian. You get so into a habit. It's almost like Christendom. And so it's not moving. It's not impactful because it's just a cliche. It's empty. And so that's what happens. We say things and it's just a cliche. And so God help me to smell a professional Christian versus someone who literally is moving as God is speaking. So we learned that a professional Christian just puts church on, puts church off, right? They just come, I got my hour, hour and a half, 2 hours, and I'm good. And they do their thing, right? And then we also learn they can be religious. A professional Christian can be religious. And so God said, well, I'm taking my church, it's his church. I'm not coming for religion. I'm coming for a people. Right? And so we learn that. And then we learn that a professional Christian can be self-contained. They're not serving the Lord with gladness. They're not serving in the house of God. They're not, you know, making God a priority. They're just self-contained. So we can become very easily a professional Christian. And I'm going to tell you straight up, the enemy is not impressed. I mean, his goal is to get us to become professional Christians. Let them go to church. Let them get their religion in. Let them be about themselves and do nothing for the kingdom. He's good. Yeah. So we have to know the objective of the enemy. But God told us very clearly in 1 Peter 2:11, beloved, here it is. Remember, you don't belong in this world. There it is. You are sojourners, living in exile. So resist the desire to settle for the pleasures. Look at that. And so we as believers have to recognize that God has a mission, and his mission what?
Has a church.
So when you gave your heart to the Lord, you became part of his mission. And so that's where we've been hanging out. The last thing we said, and before we get into today's part, that Christians are rooted. They're rooted. They're like plants. They are present. They compel people to come. And the last thing we said is that ambassadors are witnesses and not what? Help me finish it. Judges. Exactly. And so the last time I was before you in Ambassadors Keeping It Real, I'm in the acronyms, we learned that we're AAA people. Did we not? So we learned that we are adopted. In other words, I think I told my testimony that my family, my siblings, and I were adopted. My father adopted us. My mother was a widow with four children, and he adopted us. He went to my biological family and got permission, and they agreed. We were in Oklahoma City, and he adopted us. But one thing he told us when he adopted us was that in the state of Pennsylvania, where it was filed, that adoption is absolutely irrevocable. And so, in other words, you can't put me back. You can't change your mind. Don't you love that? And so when you understand that natural principle, I put that before you because God told us in Romans that we are adopted. Absolutely adopted, and in sonship that we can absolutely call the Father Abba Daddy. We have the right to do that. And so what happens is many people grow up and don't have a relationship in the natural on what a father looks like. And when they come to the Lord, it's like, what? You are my daddy? You are father? And so God has to renew our minds that if you didn't have a relationship in the natural with a father, he becomes that father. And so you can get to the Lord at 30, 35, but you're still God's little girl. You're still God's little boy. Are you understanding this? You are a child of God. And we learned that he chose you. He absolutely wanted me. I was handpicked. He appointed me, and he set me aside for him. Then we learned, this is the big one, that not only am I adopted, but he gave me authority. That's the last thing we said before you. He gave me authority as his child to literally step on serpents and scorpions. And so what does that mean? It doesn't literally mean snakes and bugs, because I don't like neither one. So what we learned, that to step on serpents, serpents are dividers. They're the ones that divide. They're the ones that deceive. And we have the right to literally have authority over every deceptive spirit that tries to deceive us and the scorpions that try to divide us. We have authority over that. And nothing that the enemy puts together and cooks up will harm me. That's how powerful I am. And so we've been saying that the reason why God did that is because he wants your life and my life to live out loud. That tells the other people that yes, there are snakes. Yes, there's serpents. Yes, there's scorpions. Yes, there's things that try to deceive me and divide my life and get me distorted off my game. But what we learn, I live my life out loud, letting you know I'm challenged at times. I have difficulties, but God meets me. He keeps me. He reminds me I'm adopted and I have authority in him. I live out loud. And so all I can do is say to you is that I haven't put on my A game. God help me to put on, did we not remember this, my A game. Someone sent me an email after the message last week about this A game. And I looked it up, remember? And I learned that the A game literally means an expression by athletes. Remember that one? And it means that you are on your top attitude and ability because today's competition is going to be strong and you need to put on your A game. But this lady, young lady, sent me a text, or actually an email, and she said that she was looking for a job. And so the name of the job said, put on your A game. And so I'm like, okay, so I checked it out, and it said, even when you're looking for employment, said this article, put on your A game. Have the right attitude, be prepared to adapt, have a heart of ambition, be action-oriented, be able to announce yourself. I mean, it went on, it was 10 different ingredients, all starting with A,
of course,
about putting on your A game. So if you want the A job, put on your what? Come on, A game. And so that's what this was saying, those ingredients for the A game. I love that. And so it said to go in and put it on. And so it's almost like when you get up in the morning, you make a decision to put it on. Say, God, the enemy wants to put on heaviness. He wants to put on what's not right in my life, the challenges in my life. But help me to choose to put on the A game. And I don't mean faking. I don't mean phony. I don't mean pretending that things are a certain way. But it's an attitude adjustment by God. Are you understanding? God, I need an adjustment today. There's that A. And that was one of them. God, help me to adapt and to make the adjustments necessary to be your ambassador. Are you understanding this? That is not on accident, doesn't it? It's intentional. I literally, God helping me. And so God help me not to go into where you're taking me on my job or wherever I'm assigned, there's that A, without my A game. That's why we challenge you, don't roll out the house and not say hello to Jesus. Even if you're brushing your teeth, I gave you a very simple way of putting on your A game. God, I'm brushing my teeth from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. I praise you. Did you brush your teeth? I mean, you have a habit, right? And so that habit of brushing your teeth is the same habit of saying, God, help me today. I'm including you in my day because I see my day going sour and I got to bring on my A game. And so what that does, when you put God in the equation, it literally helps make Jesus irresistible. So somebody will walk up to you and say, I know you're having a rough time. How in the world are you getting through this day? How in the world are you smiling? And you say, I'm not. I put on my A game. I got help, girlfriend. I got some help this morning. I called on my daddy. Your daddy, your who? Yeah, I called my daddy. Well, that's spooky. You called your daddy to get some help? Yes. Well, who is your daddy? You got 5 minutes? Are you understanding? It's literally saying, listen, I am not leading this life fake. I'm not leading this life like I don't have challenges. What I am saying, with God, all things are possible. With him. Only with him. And so that gives you an opportunity to give them a little invite card. So you want some of this? Remember? So we gave you those because our life is not our own. This meal is to be shared. This news, this gospel good news is to be shared. It's not to be just for us. I have good news, even amid bad stuff. Did we not learn that? All right, so here's where we're headed today. Today is the real tea. Ambassadors for real, the real tea. And so, you know, I'm God has to help me. I'm so into acronyms. I don't know where that came from. I got a fresh anointing for acronyms. I mean, they just flow. Now, I can tell you the truth. I learned all through college, that's how I passed tests. I literally made up acronyms. And when I was taking the test, I said, SOAP. And I just remember, you know, what the S-O-A-P. That's how I memorized stuff, was through acronyms. That was I don't call it cheating. That's just the way my mind worked. And I passed. You know, I did fail a few classes, but I'm standing here, right, you know. And so the real T is to tell the truth. Now, when I was growing up, you know, there were people in the neighborhood gossiping and talking about people. And, you know, and so some people would say, listen, I heard this, I heard that. But then somebody would say, but give me the real tea. Yes, I grew up in Oklahoma. Anybody ever hear that? Am I the only Oklahoman up in here that heard, give me the real tea? Y'all know what that means? Y'all Pennsylvanians don't know what the real tea means? But it's like, give me the real tea. I heard this, but tell me the real scoop. You can look at it like that. Go with somebody that really knows what went down. So that's what this means. Give me somebody that knows what really went down. Yeah. So that's where we're going to hang out today. And the reason for that is, listen at this, there are people, if I ask the number one plot of the enemy when it comes to your family, your assignment at work, your community, and I dare say society and the world at large, there is a quest for truth. People are searching for what?
Truth.
Yeah. And so here's the deal. You and I have a past, and we have a future. This is one example of this truth thing. And so we have an element of negativity in our past. Let's be real about it. All of us. And so my past may be negative, but my future is positive. Are you seeing this? And so I have to make a decision to turn on the future. I have to make a decision to do what? Turn on the future. Otherwise, the enemy will make sure your negative is on replay. And so people are on a quest for truth, and because the negative replay is going over and over and over. So well, here's the deal. So what we're dealing with, we're talking about ambassadors, the real tea. There is a war on truth. I'm presenting this to you. There is an absolute war around the world about what truth looks like, what truth is, what truth belongs. If you really think about, we have a convo cafe today, cutting a ribbon. In that convo cafe, we're going to pray over it and dedicate it for all that God wants to accomplish with young people and conversations in that room. But I'm telling you, every conversation is going to be around the truth. Can the truth come out of this? What is the truth about anxiety? What is the truth about this? I'm telling you, there is a war on truth. Now, yes, that's the truth. Somebody said that's the truth. There's a war on truth, and that's the truth. Yeah. And so I'm putting before you, why did God do this when he's talking about ambassadors, the people that he deputized, the people that he chose, the people that he adopted, the people that he anointed, the people that he assigned, the people that he saved? Why is there a war on truth? And I'm going to tell you that the fact that you are living on the edge of 2020, why would God choose you to be breathing in this generation when the highest war of truth is at stake? Why would God handpick you to be in a warfare in a generation that's in search for truth? At this, I'm telling you, it's absolutely intense. And so what happens is, stay with me, truth gets distorted.
Yeah.
And so here's an acronym. See, here we go. I can't help it. I was like, God, I can't help this. What the heck? I can't help it. So truth, T-R-U-T-H, gets distorted. The first way it gets distorted is when you go through something. The enemy wants you to have a test. He wants you to have trials. He wants you to have situations, tears, and troubles. And as you go through that, it distorts the truth. If God loved me, why am I going through this?
Wow.
He starts right there. If God was with me, why am I in pain? If God was God, why this? And so the enemy distorts the truth with your tests, your trials, your tears, your troubles, your trauma, your tragedy. Are you hearing this?
Yeah.
The second way he distorts the truth, we start rationalizing. God told me, he said, people start rationalizing. Well, that can't be true in the word of God. I mean, if God meant that, maybe he meant this. We start rationalizing. We start trying to reason our way into what we want than what the real deal is. We start rationalizing. And so people are watering down the word of God so they can get connected, they think, to God, but they still want their way. And so God said, listen, the truth is getting distorted because people are rationalizing. Well, God didn't mean that really. I know it's in the Bible, but that's a different translation. Rationalizing. Woo-wee. And then the enemy's really big at this one. Undermining the word. He did that to Jesus, so you know he's going to do it to us. He asked Jesus, if you're the Son of Man, turn that stone into bread. And Jesus was smart like he wants us to be. He said, devil, I don't owe you an explanation. I know who I am. I'm adopted. I have authority. And I'm an ambassador. It is written. Get out of my face. But the enemy wants to undermine the word. That's another level of distorting. Somebody help me say truth.
True.
Yeah, that's what we're. And then here's another T. He wants you to be around negative talk. You hear the truth, and somebody's negative, all in your ear, with all, well, if God was loving you, if this was this, if you had that, if maybe you need to do this. And so you're around a bunch of negative talk. And so by the time you get through with people on Instagram and Messenger and all the social media, you were joyful, and now you're down. Why? You're around negative talk. And so negative talk is going to be around you. It's what you do with it. It's not the action, it's our reaction that God is after. So God said, there's a lot of negative talk. That distorts the truth. The last one is H, we hear others' opinion. Others' opinion. How many know opinion won't get you to heaven? Opinion won't deliver you. Opinion won't set you free. Everybody has an opinion. And so yeah, to your friends, I'm good, I hear your opinion, but the word says. Are you hearing this? It is written. I appreciate your opinion, but it is written. You see why we have to know the truth? Come on now. Ooh, I need to move. And so listen at this one. When the truth is distorted because there's an enemy distorting it at the helm. So I love this word. If the devil's mouth is moving, he's lying.
That's it.
John 8:44. Check it out in your own app. But the Bible says, young people, the devil is the father of lies. Somebody say father. See, we're talking about fathers. Abba adopted me, but the father of lies distorts the truth. And so the Bible says he is the father of lies, and there's no truth in him. In other words, it's impossible for truth to come out. Woo-wee. And so here's the big one. Here's the big one. This is what Satan does. He flips the script. That is the goal for the rest of your life, that God has an amazing script for your purpose. The Bible says he knows the plans he has for me, and they're going to prosper me and not harm me, and they're going to give me hope and expect it in, and the enemy wants to flip the script. That is his job. To flip the script on every family, to flip the script on every marriage, to flip the script on every person. But somebody say, he's a lie. Oh, yeah, yeah. And the father of him. And so what that means is, if he's the father of lies, look at this. Every father has seed. And so there's seed. And so it's like a child being born. There's seed. And so the woman can't have a child without seed. And so the lie has what? Seed. He's the father of lies, and lies have what? Come on, seed. And so what has happened, the Lord showed me this while I was putting it together. He said, what has happened, we have generations of babies from a lie. I'm not talking physical babies. I'm talking curses, addictions, all kinds of stuff on families because there was a seed sown of a lie. And so we know the truth, then we have authority, somebody say authority, to cancel the seed. Woo-wee! And so for a few minutes, I'm just going to give you truth statements. I heard these. I'm just going to throw them out there. So beware of a half-truth. You may have gotten the wrong half. Just throwing that out there. Just throwing that out there. Just throwing that out there. Truth, and keep it going. Truth is truth, even if no one believes it. A lie is a lie if everybody believes it.
Truth is truth.
I'm talking about ambassadors with the real T.
Yes.
And so in a society where truth is at war, and God could save you in 2019 and have you go into a brand new decade as an ambassador with the real T. Truth is truth, whether anybody believes you on your job or not. Whether a family member agrees with you or not, truth stands. Well, everybody's doing it, so it's still a lie. It doesn't make it truth. Are we understanding this? And so God wants our young people and older people to know the truth. I'm making truth statements. Truth sounds like hate to those who hate truth. I'm just throwing this out there. See, we're talking about ambassadors, the real tea.
Yeah. It's the truth, though.
Truth sounds like hate to those who what? Come on, help me finish it. Yeah, yeah. And how many of you know, let's be real. I know you know the Lord, you got saved, but every now and then God tells me a truth about me and I don't like it. So you can be saved and hate truth. Like, God, I don't like that. I don't want to do that. That's my money. I don't want to give that. Now, let's be real about it. We're still making a statement. One of the most expensive things you can do is pay attention to wrong people. We're talking about ambassadors with the real T. So when you give attention to the wrong people, you engage in a lie. And that lie appears to be truth. Oh, Lord, help us. But as ambassadors, this is where we're going. I got to wrap it up. As ambassadors, we know and have. Somebody say know and have. The real tea. Yeah, 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 yeah. So listen, because you know and have the real tea, do you know ice is cold? Come on, help me finish this. Do you know ice is cold? Do you know fire is hot? Are you convinced ice is cold? Are you convinced fire is hot? Yeah, yeah, so the same knowing. I'm talking about knowing. That's what God wants us to have. So you can know the truth and not live it. You know ice is cold. You know fire is hot. You can know the truth and not live it. God help us. But here's the big one. I was putting this together. But you can't live it and not know it. Ooh. I can know the truth and not live it. But it's absolutely impossible to live the truth and not know it. We're talking about the real tea. I'm putting it in your face. So here's where we're going in my final few moments. So truth, here's the question. Is truth knowable?
Absolutely.
When a generation, there's a war on truth. Is truth knowable? So number one, you have to know that you know that you know that you know that you know. Do you know ice is cold? Do you know fire is hot? Do you know that you know that you know who the truth is? Oh, my God, help me get through this. So here's the question. John 8:32. This is our main scripture. Ambassadors, the real tea. The Bible says in your app, in your Bible, wherever you are listening, in John 8:32, I preached this message, I'm talking 5-7 years ago, particularly in this text, and the Lord brought it back. And so you shall know the truth, and the truth will do what? Set you free. And so here's where we have to go. We often say we believe something to be true about God, but our lives don't show that we actually, come on, help me say, believe it. Now, so believing something, are you listening, is equivalent to knowing. I asked you, do you believe ice is cold? And you said yes. You know that it's cold. You have to believe and know that it's cold. Come on now. You have to believe and know fire is hot. Right? And so you, if you believe that God said something, our life needs to add up with what he said. Oh, God, help me. And so my belief system is equivalent to what I know. And so Jesus was very simply asking a question to one of his disciples. He said, now people are talking. Who am I out there? You know, people are saying, and they said, some people say you're Elisha. Some people say you're a prophet. Some people say you're a Messiah. Some people just making different perceptions of who you are. And God said, that's good. But who do you say that I am? Am I ice? Is ice cold to you? Who do you say that I am? So this question is very personal. I have to know that I know that I know that I know who he is. And so this is where we're going. And so if Job says, I know in whom my Redeemer lives, if Paul says, I know in whom I believe that nothing can separate me in Romans 8 from the love of God, he goes on to say, if Mary says, blessed is she that believeth, it shall be a performance of things spoken of the Lord in Luke 1. If John said, if you believe in this Jesus, you shall be saved, I'm telling you, if they know, the question is, do we know? That we know, and we know again. And the reason why I'm putting that before you is because the Lord spoke in this series and he said, I'm equipping ambassadors to be on their A game on behalf of the kingdom. And the one problem I'm dealing with is that they don't know. They did know. Now they need to know again. Because the truth got distorted by what they went through. Come on, you remember, by rationalizing, by the word being undermined, come on now, by negative talk, they got, by hearing voices and opinions, they need to know, somebody say again. Yeah. And so what happens is, God doesn't want us to speculate of who he is. He doesn't want us to fluctuate on who he is. We have to know.
Thank you, God.
Even in my challenges, even in my questions, even in the conditions that are very difficult, God, help me not to speculate.
Wow, Jesus.
That you're God. Help me not to, somebody say fluctuate. Wow. Yeah. He's God, he's not, he's God. He might be, you can get your way to heaven in a few ways, but I don't know, but yeah. Either he's God. Or he's not. Either you know ice is cold or it's not. Either fire is hot. Come on now. We have to know. That's number one. And so we have to know. And in knowing, I was at an event. I told you this, I think, a few months back, speaking at this event. And I don't know how we got on the topic, but the question was, a lot of our young people are very challenged. And some teachers would say to the child in school, you know better. And the other teacher said to the teacher, they don't. The kids are not brought up the way you were brought up. You're assuming that they know. And they don't. And so there's a saying, when we know better, we do better. But the ultimate goal of the enemy is to distort your better. Keep you from knowing better. And so when it comes to relationships and making decisions and choices, the enemy wants to keep you naive. He wants to keep you under the old way of thinking. So you end up with the same results, even though you're saved, you're getting worldly results. Why? Because you don't know better. You don't have the truth. You've not been taught about the relationships and God's order. You don't understand that. And so we don't submit ourselves to truth and teaching. And so we come to Christ, but have we changed? And have we allowed the word of God to change the way we think? When we change the way we think, it helps us change the way we roll. Woo-wee! And so hang out for a minute In John chapter 8:32, you shall know, somebody say no, the truth, and the truth will make you free. Did we not say that? So in that, here's the part one. Part one for ambassadors, the real tea, you have to know. All right? And so, no, there's two words in that same verse. Verse 32, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The word know is in there twice, and the word truth is in there twice. Well, the truth is in there twice. So there's two truths. The first truth is aletheia with an A. I'm trying to help you understand this. And so in John chapter 8, verse 32, you shall know the truth. That truth, aletheia, is the truth about you. Aletheia is the truth about me. And so aletheia, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. That whole text in John 8, what's so wonderful about this, is in that story, there was a woman, the Bible says, who was caught in the very act of adultery. And so the disciples, what happened was, the disciples threw up before Jesus and said, we caught her in the very act. And Jesus, of course, being God, looked at the situation. I love him. He didn't judge right away. He just looked at him, and they were saying, we caught her, God. And so the Bible says that Jesus never opened his mouth. He began to write, the Bible says, in the ground. And the words that he wrote was, he that's without sin, let them cast the first stone. In other words, boys, disciples around me, if you are without sin, go ahead and stone her. Now, what you have to remember, in the Bible days, when a person was caught in that act, they were stoned. That was literally a practice. And so Jesus was saying, if you got it like that, if you see this woman, go ahead and stone her. But what's so wonderful, the one who knew no sin didn't cast the stone. And so the Bible says, it goes on to say in that text, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. There's two words in that in the Greek, aletheia and aletheio. Check it out your own self. Study it yourself. And so in that aletheia to aletheio, the truth, you shall know the truth. Niecy, I'm going to tell you about you, and I, aletheia, am going to, the truth will set you free. So when we're dealing in this, it's like there's love, there's three types of love in the Bible, there's two types of faith in the Bible, your faith, his faith, and there's two truths in this very text. And so you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And so what God does, for the rest of my life, God reveals truth to me about me. But so what's so wonderful, for the rest of my life, I'm being set free from me. For the rest of my life, somebody help me say, I'm being set free from who? Exactly. So there's a truth about me that God helps me discover, and he sets me free in it. Woo-wee! And so look at this. So you shall know the truth. And the truth, only the person can set you free. Yes. Only the truth can set us free. I can't set you free. You can't set you free. Your neighbors can't set you free. The Lord's church can't set you free. Jesus is the truth. Amen. So if you check out the word, the truth, check it out. Do your own study. That's why we have to study. When you do it yourself, the Bible says in John 14:6, Jesus is the way, the truth. That same word in John 14:6 is the same word in John 8:32. You shall know what? Come on. The truth. And the truth will set you free. And so what God wants us to do as ambassadors with the real tea is to put people on notice that the Son, whom the Son, see, this is what's so wonderful. You go back to John 8, just go up a few verses. It goes on to say, and the Son sets free. The tea, the Son, the truth sets free. And when he does it, you're free indeed. I mean literally, the indeed in those actions. Study it in the Greek. And when you understand, I'm free in that. And for the rest of my life, I'm being set free indeed. God is continuing to, I am free and I'm being set free. Do you see this? I'm free and I'm being set free. I'm free and I'm being set free. I'm saved. I'm going to heaven, guys. That's settled, but I'm still being delivered. The Bible says to work out your own soul salvation with fear and trembling. Well, wait a minute. I thought I got saved. I thought that was done. And so I'm saved. I'm literally set free, delivered, and I'm still being saved and set free. Why? Because the perfect God is perfecting me. He's begun a good work, says Philippians 1:6. And he's perfecting it until the day. How long? To the day of Jesus Christ. And so to the day of Jesus Christ, I'm being perfected. You're looking at an imperfect person up here who's not the same I was in 2018. Hallelujah. Better in 2019 and going to get gooder in 2020. Why? I'm going to be more like him in 2020. Less of me and more of him. And so if you want to get along, get more of him. Ooh, and less of yourself. My God, my God. Somebody put it this way. The only freedom that a man ever has is when he becomes a slave to Jesus Christ. In other words, I literally submit myself to the kingship of this king and to the one who is the truth. Number two, I got to wrap it up. So we have to know as an ambassador the real tea. The second thing we have to do, we have to have the truth. I have to know the truth and I have to have the truth. And so in Psalm 51, verse 6 and 7, as we wrap this up, David said, God, you desire truth in the inward parts. Now, that's a different truth. That's the same truth. That word truth in that verse is aletheia. And so he said, you desire truth in the inward parts. In that whole chapter, what you may not know is that David was going through. He just had an adulterous situation with Bathsheba. And the Bible says that he told the Lord, listen, create in me a clean heart. Do something in me. Create the right spirit in me. And the Bible says, he said, God, you desire truth in the inward parts. And in the hidden part, thou shalt make known your wisdom. Purge me. Cleanse me. Make me white as snow. That is Psalm 51, verse, again, 6 and 7. We're talking about you have to have, ambassadors have the truth. They know the truth, and they have the truth. And so when you leave here with the real tea, you're going to leave here saying, I know the truth, and I have the truth. Are you understanding? And so 1 John, give me a few scriptures. 1 John 4, 1 through 6. We're talking about having the truth. And so in 1 John, it reads like this. For you are of God, little children, and you have overcome them. What's them? The world. Because greater is he that's in you than he that is in the world. They are of the world. That's what we were, but we're not now. Therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. But we are of God, that he, come on, say knows. Knows God and hears us. He that is not of God hears, doesn't hear God. But we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. So when you come to the Lord, what God wants you to know as an ambassador, you need to know the difference between the spirit of what? Truth and the spirit of what? Exactly. So we're dealing with the war on truth. And so the ultimate goal of the enemy is that you come to church, but you still go home, you're around friends and family, and the spirit of error is all around. But here's what's so wonderful. God didn't depend on me. He didn't depend on you to determine the truth. He gave us help. So we have the Holy Spirit. Somebody say have. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. So as an ambassador, you have the Holy Spirit. So the Bible says the spirit of truth comes. Woo-wee. He will guide you into how much truth? Come on, truth. He will not speak of his own. Come on now. But he will speak whatever. Come on. He hears. So the Holy Spirit hears and speaks to us. Are you seeing this? I have the Holy Spirit. And so he also, here's the rest of it, will also declare to you what is to come.
Yes, thank you, God. Hallelujah.
And so I have the Holy Spirit. It's not an it. I have the person of the Holy Spirit living on the inside of me and the greater one. And so the Holy Spirit leads me and guides me, and he helps me discern the difference between the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Woo-wee! Ah! And so I have the Holy Spirit. So what does that mean? That means I'm not condemned, but I can get convicted. Amen. You understand? It doesn't sit well. Like, oh, that's not true. That something's not right there. I'm not feeling that. The Holy Spirit on the inside puts a check, like, get out of there. Hang up that phone. Say goodbye. Block it. Let it go. Loose it. Nah, you don't need that. You had that, but let that go. Truth on the inward parts. Are you understanding? You have the truth. If you know the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord drew you to him. You have the Holy Spirit. And we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That's another whole teaching. Have you received since you believed? But even as you received him, the Spirit of God drew you, the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. And so when you're tempted to go left or to go right, the Holy Spirit will say, right here, stay right here. And so what the enemy wants to do is to get us, here's the big one, he wants to get us dependent, so dependent on people that we don't know truth for ourselves. And so I'm going to submit to you, have you had a good talk with the Holy Spirit? Have you given him permission to lead your life? The Bible says that he that are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. Yes. The mature ones. The ones that say, you know what, God, show me what to do. Show me how to handle this. Do I cross every T and dot every I? Absolutely not. But my intention, come on now, is to glorify God. My intention is to do the right thing. God helping me as only he can. In fact, the Bible equates the Holy Spirit as your helper. The Holy Spirit is the comforter, the one called alongside to help you know the truth. Now, we're still talking about, I got to wrap it up. We're still talking about, I know the truth as an ambassador with the real T. And somebody say, I have the truth. And so the Bible says, in wrapping this up, that we are to gird our loins with the belt of truth. So when you put on the whole armor of God, I don't have time to get into all this, but it's important that you know the first thing, the first part of the armor is truth. There's an order. God said, put on the gird your loins with truth. In other words, you can't even have the helmet of salvation and not have truth. You can't have the breastplate of righteousness and not have truth. You see the order? I love you, so smart. God said, get the truth round your behind. Get the truth in your inward parts that can tell you to discern and to get the conviction and to say, God, is that you, God? Oh, that's you, God. No, that's not you, God. Get that truth around you. Get dressed with the truth. Woo-wee! My God. And so when we have the truth and we know the truth as ambassadors, I can say, God, who do you say that I am, Niecy? God, help me not to say, God, I know that you're God, but this. God, I know that you got to understand this. No, God, help me by the power of the Holy Spirit to say, God, you're God, whether I feel like it or I don't, whether I understand or I don't, whether I can figure it out or I can't, you're still God. And that's the real tea. That's the real tea. He's looking for ambassadors that don't have to have it all together. We live out loud. We're all learning together. We're all leading a life to build the kingdom. But the one resolve I have, he's God. I said he's God. He's a sovereign God. And so the Lord had to teach me that. It was a personal lesson in figuring out things. And said, God, prayed for this for so many years, and it blew up in my face. I'm talking about in the 90s. And God, I remember, some of you know the story, and I had to get to that place over wonton soup when I was invited to a Kingdom Hall and somewhere else. And some people were saying, well, since your God let you down, come with us. Are you understanding this? Come with us. And so as ambassadors, how many of you know, my message has to say, come with me. Yeah. I said, my to be what? Come on, come on. Come with me. Yes, thank you. Come with me. And so we won't allow those T's. I got so happy I got out of place. So, So the last slide, we literally are done. Literally. Well, the last word is that the ambassadors have to know the T. They have to know the T. They have to know and have. Somebody say have. The T. And so as we go, my time is up. And I truly thank you for yours. I truly thank you for yours. Ambassadors with the real T.
Greetings, and thank you for tuning in today to hear God's word to us. I really believe that we are a people of purpose. In other words, you did not tune in on accident. And so before we end this broadcast, I'm just sharing with you why I believe the Lord had you to join us. Number one, you may be in a storm right now. Number two, you're restless, there's no peace. Number three, you may be in fear. The list can go on and on. But I believe that whatever we're going through, God's word says he's the God of all flesh and there's nothing too hard for him. And so before we end this broadcast, won't you pray this prayer with me and allow Jesus to become Lord and Savior of your life? The word says that when we do that, old things are passed away and everything that we've gone through is passed away. And behold, all things have become new. And so I want to offer you new life with Jesus. I'm not offering you a religion. I'm not offering denomination. I'm simply offering you a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Won't you repeat this prayer after me? Father God, thank you for locating me. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to make you the Lord of my life. I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. You said I would be saved. I would be born again. I would become a Christian and old things would be passed away. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today, we celebrate your new life. And in order to do that, we ask that you call the Lord's Church or email us. You'll see the information on our website at tlcnewlife.org. And we'd be happy to send you out some information on this new life with Jesus. If you don't have a local church where you can grow in the things of God, we welcome you to join us this Sunday at 10 a.m. at the Lord's Church. Until next time, remember, Jesus is Lord, and he's more than enough to be in your situation. God bless you. See you next time.